بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه أما بعد. This is our 29th lesson going through the book مختصر أبي شجاع في الفقه على مذهب الإمام الشافعي رحمه الله تعالى وطبع القاضي أبو الحسين أحمد بن الحسين بن أحمد الأصفهاني رحمه الله تعالى. الحمد لله. We are still in كتاب البيوع and we have arrived at فصل. وكل ما جاز للإنسان التصرف فيه بنفسه جاز له أن يوكل أو يتوكل فيه. So this is the concept of al-wakala or al-wikala, which linguistically means التفويض. Essentially what you're doing is you're hiring somebody to do a job for you. So you're hiring an agent to do a job that you can do yourself, but he's doing it for you. For example, let's say you make a shop or you build a shop. You now want to run the shop, but you hire an agent to do that job for you. مثلا you want to get a bunch of products into your shop مثلا, but you want someone else to do it for you, and so you hire somebody else as an agent to do that job for you. مثلا, you want to enter into a negotiation with somebody, so you hire an agent to do the negotiation on your behalf. This is al-wikala, and this is permissible. This is permissible in what كل ما جاز الإنسان التصرف فيه بنفسه جاز له أن يوكل أو يتوكل فيه. Anything that is permissible for a person to act out by himself. So basically, there is something here that I can do by myself, with myself, right? I'm allowed to hire someone else to do it for me, or me being the one being hired to do that thing. So now I can be either someone who's hiring somebody to do it, or I can be the one that's being hired to do that, or to do a thing. طيب. This is what we call al-wakala. And essentially, there are four parts to it, or there are four pillars to it. Al-muwakkil, wal-wakil, wal-muwakkalu fihi, wal-sigha, right? You need to have person A who's doing, i.e. the agent, the one who's being hired to do the job, right? Likewise, the one doing the hiring, so you need those two. Likewise, you need the job itself, right? What is the act that this person is going to be doing for me that I'm allowed to do for myself, but I'm letting someone else do it for me, right? And then there has to be a sigha, a way in which you convey this contract, i.e. You're saying that, yes, I hire you to be my agent, to be responsible for me in doing said action. Okay, so this is the pillars of the wakala. And there are, يعني, when it comes to al-mu'amalat al-maliyah, it's a very, very general, and it can apply across the board. There are many, many examples. You can go into, مثلا, an example that you can give in marriage, مثلا. Let's say you are a wali, and you're marrying off your daughter, but you don't have an understanding of the Arabic language, for example, and so you say, I hire this person as an agent, as my wakil, to what? To do the, to conduct the marital ceremony on my behalf. That's allowed. Or مثلا, I'm not in the country, but my daughter's getting married, right? And so I say, I hire this person as my wakil to do the job of what? Of marrying off my daughter to said, or to another individual. طيب. That is permissible, and this is an act of, it is a type of wikala. And so wikala enters into many different mu'amalat. When it comes to ibadat, however, there are only two acts of worship that wikala enters in. So, مثلاً, can I say to somebody, I give this person the responsibility of praying my salah for me? Is that allowed? The answer is no. So when it comes to ibadat, it's quite restrictive. The wikala is restrictive, and it only applies in two acts of worship when we talk about ibadat badaniyah, and that is al-hajj. And of course, on the condition that the person who's doing the wakala, the one who is saying to another person, you are the one responsible now for making hajj on my behalf, this person who's doing that must be unable to do the hajj. So مثلا, he's extremely sick and he's unable to do the hajj. So he hires somebody to go and do the hajj for him. That's permissible, right? And likewise, in tafriqat al-zakat, in the distribution of the zakat, you can hire someone to do that for you. So the zakat is an act of worship, right? So you can't say someone, I'm going to get someone else to pay the zakat for me. You can't do that. But can I get someone to distribute the zakat for me? That's permissible. So these are the only two acts of worship that are ibadat badaniya, in which wakala is permissible. That you can hire an agent to do the act of worship for you. طيب. In this case, tafriqat al-zakat, distributing the zakat, and also al-hajj, for the one, of course, who is unable to do the hajj. However, when it comes to the mu'amalat, it's as we said, the qa'idah, كُلُّ مَا جَازَ لِلْإِنسَانِ التَّصَرُّفُ فِيهِ بِنَفْسِهِ جَازَ لَهُ أَنْ يُوَكِّلَ أَوْ يَتَوَكَّلَ فِيهِ. And then he said, وَالْوَكَالَةُ عَقْدٌ جَائِزٌ. What does this mean? The wakala, as we know, the uqood, the contracts, there are contracts that are binding and contracts that are non-binding. The wakala falls under non-binding contracts, meaning that the one who has been hired, he can easily break off the contract. without any problem. Likewise, the one who did the hiring can easily break off the contract as well. So مثلا going back to our example of the marriage that we said, I'm a wali of a girl, my daughter for example, and I am not in the country. So I say I hire this person as my wakil to do the marriage ceremony for me, i.e. to be in my position on the day of the nikah. So this is a wikala. I'm hiring this person as my wakil. Now he, the one who's been hired, can easily refuse. He said, after the exception. So let's say we both agreed, so the contract was done. He's now my wakil on that day. After that contract came, this contract is not binding upon him, meaning he does not have to hold on to that contract. He does not have to obey that contract. He can say at any time, I break the contract and I'm not going to do it. Find someone else. Or me, as the one who was doing the hiring, I can also break off the contract, say, I don't want you no longer as my wakil, I'm going to find someone else as my wakil. That's permissible. Because the wakala, this contract, is aqd which is غير لازم. It's an aqd which is non-binding. طيب. Which is why the author said, aqd جائزٌ. طيب. And then he said, وَلِكُلِّ مِنْهُمَا فَسْخُهَا مَتَشَى. And anyone can break it, both sides can break it anytime they want. طيب. And that again hints at the point that I mentioned, right? وَلِكُلِّ مِنْهُمَا فَسْخُهَا مَتَشَى. That you can break off this contract anytime you want, both sides, right? Both sides. Have this option. So it's a aqd which is غير لازم, and of course we said the wakala is a jais, is a permissible contract as well. وتنفسخ بموت أحدهما. The contract comes to an end, so the tawkeel, the wakala, comes to an end when one of the sides passes away or one of the sides loses sanity. So you can also add on to it as well, al-junun, right? So if one of the sides becomes insane and no longer capable of holding on to the contract, for example through death or through losing their sanity, then the contract comes to an end and that person is no longer a wakil responsible for the individual who hired this person as a wakil. طيب والله تعالى أعلم. Then the author رحمه الله said, والوكيل أمين فيما يقبضه وفيما يصرفه. So this wakil that you've entrusted as your agent, he is entrusted in that which he's going to collect and in that which he's going to spend. So in the example that we gave in the previous slide, if this person that you have entrusted to be in the position that you are as a wali for your daughter, he is responsible or he's entrusted with giving your daughter to the man, right? So when the marital contract takes place, he is the one who is the wakil for you, who's taking your position. And so he's the one who's what? He's doing what? At-tasrif. He's giving your daughter to said individual, right? Another example, let's say you hire someone to work in your shop, or مثلا you hire someone to go and collect for you a delivery, right? This person has now been entrusted to collect those items. So هو أمين فيما يقبضه وأيضا فيما يصرفه. You say to a person, here, take this money and go buy for me something. And so he is the one who's entrusted with actually spending that wealth. ولا يضمن إلا بالتفريط. Now this individual, he is not held responsible, i.e. he is not held responsible for any problem that may take place or any loss that may occur, except if there's any transgression from his side. And the way to understand this is with an example, the classic example. Let's say I hire someone to work for to work in my shop. You are my agent. I am holding you responsible for everything that occurs in my shop. And now he's now buying and selling, and he's doing what? هو أمين فيما يقبضه وفيما يصرفه. Someone comes to him and says to him, I want to buy this pen from you. Now this individual, this wakil, what he does is he gives the pen to the individual, the buyer, without taking the wealth from him, without taking the money from him first. So he gave him the product without taking the wealth first. Now when he gave him the product, this individual, instead of paying, he ran away. Now this product cost money. Who is the money responsible? Who is responsible for paying back this money? Is it me? Is the liability upon me as the one who hired this person? Or is the liability upon the one who made the mistake? The one who made the mistake is liable. So the wakil here is liable. The wakil here is liable. But in an example or a case where, let's say, an armed robber came and stole wealth or stole from the shop, there is no tafriyat here from the angle of the wakil. And so the the compensation or the liability is upon me, the one who hired the wakil, not upon the wakil himself. So the wakil is only held responsible, only held liable for any mistake that takes place on his part, any transgression on his part. If there is no transgression on his part and a problem takes place, for example, let's say you said to him, take this money, go buy for me that item, or methalan, go and collect for me that item from X or Y, and on the way he was robbed or something, or he lost the money and it wasn't his fault, it never came from his own transgression, that money, the one who is held liable for it is you, not the wakil himself. So you don't go to the wakil and say, give me back the money. La, you know, you can't do that. But if the wakil, in the example we gave, you, a shopper came and instead of taking the wealth first, he gave the product and the guy ran away, then the one who has to pay the cost of that product is who? The wakil, not you. طيب, I hope that is clear, inshallah ta'ala. Wallahu alam. Then the author, rahimahullah, he said, وَلَا يَجُوزُ أَنْ يَبِيعَ وَيَشْتَرِيَ إِلَّا بِثَلَاثَةِ شَرَائِطَ. Now, this wakil that's been hired, he can only do buying and selling if he meets these three conditions. Number one, أَنْ يَكُونَ أَوْ أَنْ يَبِيعَ بِثَمَنِ الْمِثْلِ. What does this mean? That when you are buying and selling, you must buy in accordance to the price that has been set by the market, right? Or the price that is known for that said product in the market. And so let's say I hire this person to sell me some products that I have in my shop, right? And the recommended retail price for this product is £10, right? And the buyer comes to the wakil and he says to him, let me buy that product for you from you, but for £3 or £1 or 50p instead of the £10, which is the recommended retail price. And the wakil says, yeah, okay, let's do that transaction. Is that transaction valid? The answer is no. Why? Because you've performed the ghubn fahish, you've betrayed your owner, or you betray the one who puts you in this position of responsibility, the one who hired you as his agent, because the retail price for his product is £10, and you've made it worse for this individual. You're incurring a loss for this person. Why? Because the recommended retail price is £10, and you're selling it at £3. When you were put in charge and you were given this responsibility of selling this product at the recommended retail price, you can maybe go below it a little bit, like £9.50 or something. There's no problem. But £3, £2, £1, this is ghubn fahish. And so that's not allowed. If you do that, then you've broken this condition. And if there was any problem, you will be held accountable to compensate for that error which you have made. طيب. Number two, أن يكون نقدا بنقد البلد. So we can combine these two conditions. أن يكون نقدا بنقد البلد. Meaning that the manner of transaction must be through currency. And this currency must be the currency of the country. So for example, pounds. Right, and so if someone comes to you and says to you, I want to buy this same product, you're the wakil, right? I want to buy this product from you. So method, I've hired you as a wakil to sell me this product, and someone comes to you and says, I want to buy this product for 10 rupees, not 10 British pounds, 10 rupees. Now, if I'm a wakil and someone comes to me and says, I want to buy this product from you for 10 rupees, is this a naqd? Yes, it's a naqd. But is it binaqd al-balad? La. Is it higher? Is the currency that he's mentioned, is it more valuable or less valuable? If it's less valuable, then you can't do this transaction. If it is more valuable, then you can do this transaction. So for example, if he came to say, I want to buy this product from you for 10 Kuwaiti dinar, I agree to buy this product from you for 10 Kuwaiti dinar. Can the wakil say yes? He can say yes. Why? Because the Kuwaiti dinar is more valuable than the British pound, right? If a person comes and says to the wakil, I want to buy this product from you for 10 Indian rupees, is 10 Indian rupees the same as 10 British pounds? La. 10 Indian rupees is inferior to 10 British pounds. And so you can't say yes to this transaction. Why? Because you'll be betraying the one whom you're responsible for as an agent. The one whom you are an agent for. طيب. And so that's the three conditions that must be fulfilled in order for the agent to be allowed to do what? Al-bay'u wa-shira. طيب. Then the author, rahimahullah, he said, وَلَا يَجُوزُ أَنْ يَبِيعَ مِنْ نَفْسِهِ. What does this mean? This wakil who's been put in control of my shop, can he buy products that are found in my shop from himself? I.e. this book that costs £10, can he buy it? I.e. can he buy it for himself for £10? I.e. he writes in the book, مثلاً, £10, I brought it for my own self, هذا لا يجوز. He has to come back to the muwakkil and say to the muwakkil, I want to buy this book from you for £10. And then the muwakkil gives the permission and says, yes, you can buy it for £10. He can't just do it out of his own volition and say, I'm going to buy products in the shop for my own self. He has to go to the one who gave him this responsibility. Why? Because it's potential for what? For ظلم, right? is the potential for ظلم in that this person who has been designated as a وكيل might take the mic, right, and buy this product for his own self at a less lesser price than the retail price. And so the book costs £10. He writes in the he says, I'm going to buy it for myself for £6 and not £10, right? How is the muwakkil, how is the one who originally owned the, or the one who hired you as a worker or hired you as an agent, how is he going to know that you've what, that you've done this? And so to prevent that, to prevent that potential dhulm, and likewise also to prevent the impermissibility of both sides, so the buyer and the seller being the same person. So what's haram in uquud, in transactions, is if you have the qabidh, the one who is taking the wealth, and the one who's given the wealth being the same hand. So I'm giving £10 to myself, right, as a transaction. You can't do that. There has to be two different sides. طيب. And so in this case, if you have someone who is a wakil and he's buying a product for himself, right, then the £10 that he's paying is going back to his hand, right? It's going back to his hand. And so this is something which is not allowed. طيب. And so if the wakil wants to buy a product from the shop that he's been held as an agent, he must go back to the muwakkil and say, I want to buy this product from the shop. And then the muwakkil says, yes, you can buy that product from the shop, and then that will be a valid transaction. Likewise, the author, rahimahullah, he says, وَلَا يُقِرَّ عَلَى مُوَكِّلِهِ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. Now this person is my representative, he's the wakil, looking after my shop, right? Let's say someone comes and he says, the one whom you're representing, he owes me £1,000. Can now the wakil say, yes, I am his representative, I confess that he owes you £1,000, here you go, there's the £1,000 that he owes you. Can he confess on my behalf? The answer is no. He's not allowed to do this. وَلَا يُقِرَّ عَلَى مُوَكِّلِهِ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. Abi Shuja' mentions, إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. Unless there is what? Express permission from the, or express, express permission from the muwakkil, from the one who's being represented. So if I say to him, مثلاً, my representative, I say to him, أخي, if Fulan comes and says that he, that and accuses me of owing him £1,000, agree, confess on my behalf and say, yeah, I confess on his behalf, I am his representative, I confess on his behalf that he owes you £1,000 and pay him the £1,000. Can he do this? Can the wakil enact this out? According to Abi Shuja', yes. However, according to the Mu'tamad and the Madhab, لا يصح. Even that is not allowed, because the iqrar can only be done by the muwakkil, by the one who is actually confessing. He must confess by himself. طيب والله أعلم. Then the author, rahimahullah, he said, وَالْمُقَرُّ بِهِ ضَرْبَانْ فَصْلٌ وَالْمُقَرُّ بِهِ ضَرْبَانْ. And so essentially here the author is going to be talking about مسألة الإقرار, the مسألة pertaining to الإقرار, which is confession. And we spoke about it briefly in the previous slide in the example, وَلَا يُقِرَّ عَلَى مُوَكِّلِهِ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. Right? If you have a representative, the representative can't confess on your behalf. طيب, you have to be the one who confesses. And when you are confessing, you confess either a right that belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you owe, or a right that belongs to another human being that you owe. So, وَالْمُقَرُّ بِهِ ضَرْبَانْ حَقُّ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى وَحَقُّ الْأَدَمِي. What is an example of حَقُّ اللَّهِ? مَثَلًا, you fell into zina. And then you came to the qadi and you confessed, I committed zina, and the right that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has upon me is 80 lashes if you are مثلًا a bikr, or a rajm if you are a thayyib مثلًا. Or مثلًا you committed stealing, you committed theft that necessitates qat'u al-yad, right? And so you committed that theft and you go to the qadi and you say and you confess that you committed theft, and that the haqq of Allah Azza wa Jalla in this scenario is what? Is qat'u al-yad مثلًا. So all of the huquq that are belonging to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's the first type in which you can fall in and you can confess regarding. As for the second type, وَحَقُّ الْأَدَمِي, the right that belongs to another human being. For example, you go to the qadi and you say and you confess to killing an individual. And so the haqq of the adami is what? Al-qisas or al-diyah, right? If he forgives the, if he foregoes the qisas, then you have of course the diyah, right? The blood money. Or مثلاً, you committed al-qadf, you accused a chaste woman of committing fahisha. And so you go to the qadi and you say that I committed al-qadf, I committed this slander upon a chaste woman, and so I need the had to be applied upon me, right? And so this is haqq adami. مثلا another example in معاملات will be pertaining to الأموال الديون. You go and you confess that you indeed owed X person that amount of money, and you confess to that. And so that is the two types of confessions that we have in our religion: حق لله وحق للآدميين. Then the author رحمه الله said, فحق الله تعالى يصح الرجوع فيه عن الإقرار به. When it comes to the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can retract the confession. So if you confess to committing zina, you can retract it. You can retract it. And if you retract it, then that's looked at and that's taken into consideration and that's accepted. طيب. And so let's say you go to the qadi and you say that I committed zina. And then you retract that statement. And you say, no, I did not commit zina. That is accepted. What we take is that latter statement, that retraction, not the initial statement. The initial statement is what is completely removed. And you take the latter statement, which is why the qadi, he needs to be much more detailed when it comes to taking into consideration the accusation that he's, or the confession that has been initially put forth when it comes to حقوق الله, and that he gives the individual the ability, not, he doesn't do it directly, but he indirectly suggests to this individual, are you sure that you did this? So for example, we find in the incident of Ma'iz, right, when he came to the Messenger of Allah and he confessed committing zina, what the Messenger of Allah, he said, لَعَلَّكَ قَبَّلْتَ أَوْ لَعَلَّكَ لَمَسْتَ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ, right? Maybe you only kissed, or you didn't do that which leads to, or that which is actually considered the zina, which the had is going to be applied, right? And so the Messenger of Allah, the reason why he's asking these questions is to what? Is to give an opportunity for this individual, i.e. Ma'iz, in that specific example, to retract the confession, right? And to go back on the confession that he had just made. Why? Because حقوق الله عز وجل is built upon what? العفو والمسامحة. The حقوق of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is built upon mercy and forgiveness and overlooking. And so if the person committed an act that violates the rights of Allah, and then he confesses to that, and then he retracts that confession, we take the retraction when it comes to حقوق الله. However, when it comes to حقوق الآدميين, وحق الآدمي لا يصح الرجوع فيه عن الإقرار به. If a person confesses to committing a right that violates the rights of the آدميين, then you can never retract that. If you were to retract it, مثلا, you go to the qadi and you say, I accept and I confess that this person owes me £1,000. And then you say, no, I was lying, I retract that confession. That retraction is rejected. Why? Because حقوق الآدميين, the rights of the آدميين, is built upon what? البخل, built upon greed. In that, this right has to be fulfilled for the آدمي. طيب, you've confessed to it, خلاص, you have to fulfill it. You can't retract it, you can't return it back. طيب, or you can't take it back. So وحق الآدميين أو وحق الآدمي لا يصح الرجوع فيه عن الإقرار به. And so it's important that when you confess to an act that has violated the rights of a human being, that you are 100% sure that indeed this is what you want, this is what you are confessing. You can't go back on a confession that you've made when the rights are dealing with other human beings. طيب, والله تعالى أعلم. Then the author رحمه الله, he said, وتفتقر صحة الإقرار إلى ثلاثة شرائط. Now in order for this confession to be deemed valid, three conditions are needed. Number one, البلوغ. The one doing the confession must be past the age of puberty. Number two, العقل. He must be sane. So the صغير, the one who's below the age of puberty, and he's insane, if he was to confess anything, that confession will not be valid. That confession is not taken into consideration. والاختيار, meaning he must have done it out of his own volition, i.e. he must have done it, i.e. Through his own will, i.e. without being under duress. And this is something which sadly many of us, or many people today fall foul of, right? They get tortured into what? Into confessing, right? And so this confession that they made under duress or under torture is not valid. طيب. So if these three conditions are met, then the اقرار is taken into account. وإن كان بمال اعتبر فيه شرط رابع وهو الرشد اعتبر به أو اعتبر فيه شرط رابع وهو الرشد. If the إقرار is dealing with monetary wealth, then there's a fourth condition that needs to be also fulfilled, and that the person must be رشد, i.e. must have had that ability. Number one, صلاح الدين, صلاح المال. He is valid and he is sound in his religion, sound in his financial literacy. So he's not a safih. So the opposite of rushd is what? A safih. And we spoke about a safih in masail pertaining in the masail, the issues pertaining to al-hajr, right? A safih al-mubadhir li-malihi, right? And so if the person is a safih, mubadhir li-malihi, right? This person, his his إقرار when it comes to الأموال is what? It's not accepted. His إقرار is not accepted. Why? Because he's a سفيه. He is a سفيه. We mentioned the سفيه is the one who what? Who spends his money in haram and makruh things. And we can divide the سفيه into two types. السفيه المهمل and السفيه المحجور. When it comes to the سفيه that's being spoken about in this context, it's السفيه المحجور. As for السفيه المهمل, سفيه المهمل is what we find many people today. As we know, there is no state that governs by the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in its entirety in the world today. And so in an Islamic state, in a Sharia, you will find that the one who is a Safi, his money will be seized, right? And it will be under the responsibility of a person who is sound in his financial literacy, who will then give him the money that he needs, or the items that he needs that are what necessities, those necessary items that he needs to survive. That's the Safi al-Mahjur. The سفيه المحجور is the one who, when it comes to الإقرار بالأموال, it's not accepted. But the سفيه المهمل, which is the vast amount of people today, people who spend their money on cigarettes and spend their money on things that are haram and things that are makruh, but يعني nobody is there to apply the حكم upon them, nobody is there to seize their wealth and to put them under the responsibility of someone who will buy for them what they need in terms of necessary items. This individual, when it comes to al-iqrar bil-mal, it's accepted. So if he confesses something pertaining to monetary wealth, it's accepted, it's taken. We don't consider this fourth condition, طيب, for him. However, al-safih al-mahjur, we don't consider him when it comes to al-iqrar bil-amwal. It is rejected from him, طيب, if he was to confess concerning something pertaining to al-amwal. طيب, wallahu a'lam. However, when it comes to the safih, whether it be the safih al-mahjur or safih al-muhammad, if it's something outside of wealth issues or money, monetary issues, his iqrar is accepted. For example, if he does iqrar concerning hukukullah, or مثلاً hukuk al-adamin like marriage, or pertaining to hadd al-qadhfi مثلاً, or al-qisas مثلاً, right, or retribution, these things, it's accepted. So the safih, his iqrar is taken into account in those scenarios. But anything that's related to money, the safih al-mahjur, his iqrar is not taken into account. طيب. Then the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَإِذَا أَقَرَ بِمَجْهُولٍ رُجِعَ إِلَيْهِ فِي بَيَانِهِ وَإِذَا أَقَرَ بِمَجْهُولٍ رُجِعَ إِلَيْهِ فِي بَيَانِهِ. If a person confesses, but he confesses بِمَجْهُول, what does بِمَجْهُول mean? مثلا, he says, I confess that this person owes me something. Right, أقر عليه بشيء. I confess that I owe him something. What's this something? You have to go back. The judge has to go back and seek from him clarification. What do you owe him? Because something here is what? It is a love which is majhul. It's love which is mubham, ambiguous statement. Right, and so you can't take a confession that is what ambiguous. قتلت فلانا. I killed فلان. Who's فلان? You have to confess. Who is the specific فلان that you're talking about here? Right, you have to make that explicitly clear. You can't be ambiguous. If the confession is ambiguous, then it's not accepted. Right? And the qadi has to go back to this individual and take from him and seek from him further clarification to get rid of this ambiguity. طيب؟ والله أعلم. Then the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, وَيَصِحُ الْاِسْتِثْنَاءُ فِي الْإِقْرَارِ إِذَا وَصَلَهُ بِهِ. Now, when it comes to al-iqrar, a mas'ala known as mas'alatu al-istithna can enter into it. And that is the mas'ala of exception. So you say, مثلاً, I confess that I owe fulan £100 except 50. Except 50. This is an exception, right? Meaning that the qadi would say that you owe this individual £50, not 100. Because he said 100 except 50. And so this istithna is accepted if you connect it with the confession. So the exception is accepted when you what? When you link it and you connect it to the actual confession itself. So you say, I owe him 100. That's the confession. Then straight away in that same context, you come with the exception, except for 50. And so the qadi will then write it down as well, that you owe 50, not 100. But if you came with the iqrar, and then later on you came with the exception, that exception is not accepted. Why? Because it was not connected to your confession in the same context. وَيَصِحُ الْإِسْتِثْنَاءُ فِي الْإِقْرَارِ إِذَا وَصَلَهُ بِهِ. On the condition that you connect the exception to the confession. So you say, مثلاً, I divorced my wife, or I confess that I divorced my wife 3 times except 2. And so how many talaq would be written? 1, not 3. Why? Because you came with 3 as a confession, but then you came with the exception in the same context, and you said what? Except 2, and so it's written as 3 minus 2, 1. So it's 1 talqa. But if you say I confess to divorce my wife 3 times, and then maybe later on outside of this context you then say, no, I want to come with the exception and say that there is an exception of 2, la, that's not accepted. Rather, the qadi would write it down as though as you have what? Committed a talaq, which is what talaq, there is the talaq which is 3, is counted as 3 and not counted as 1. طيب. And so, يصحه الاستثناء في الإقرار إذا وصله به. That's the madhab. Then the author رحمه الله تعالى, he said, وهو في حال الصحة والمرض سواء. A person, if he meets those conditions we've mentioned, whether he's sick or whether he is healthy, it doesn't matter, the إقرار is the same. So, مثلا, someone comes whilst in a state of health and he says that I confess that this person, that I owe this person £1,000. Then he became sick and then he makes another confession saying I owe another person £1,000. The £1,000 that he owes the person that he confessed to when he was sick and the £1,000 that he owes to fulan which he confessed to when he was healthy is treated the same. You don't put one over the other. You treat them the same. As long as, of course, the other conditions are met. طيب, and so these are some of the mabahith pertaining to الإقرار. And so we'll stop here بإذن الله. As we have come to the end of this subchapter, سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.